So it's an interesting, an engineer is talking about medicine here. So how many of you are engineers here? Or do I see anyone? Yeah, it's one of the rare scenarios in India, specifically if you are in Karnataka. You'll find more engineers everywhere than anywhere else. So I was born in a village in Rajasthan. And the nearest city where a tertiary care hospital or a hospital where you can get advanced level trauma care was 120 kilometers away from my village. Throughout my childhood, I have seen all the time people are losing their life because they don't get access to timely health care. This whole situation led to me thinking about that, what can I contribute to make sure that healthcare becomes more accessible. For that, the obvious path that I should go and become a doctor, start another hospital near to my village, and then start serving people. But I took another path. I became an engineer. I was fortunate enough to have teachers who really taught me biology using physics, who really taught me that how physics is the subject which you can use as a reference and that learn all other subjects. And biology fascinated me a lot, again, through the concepts of mechanics and engineering. Once I did engineering, I had some understanding of biology. I thought, OK, it's a cool thing. Let's now start doing something which I always wanted to do, build medical devices. I started building medical devices. But in my mind, these are something which everybody should be using. Everybody, all hospitals should need or use these devices. But nobody was buying it. And that's where it struck to me that something is there which I am doing wrong. That's where I went and then studied formally how to invent medical devices. During my study, one thing I realized about our country, that as most people in this country can't access quality health care because most of our expenses are out of our pocket. There are very few people who have insurance. This whole situation led to this. Almost around top 3% of people can access quality healthcare, no one else. Then I analyze it more, that why healthcare is so expensive, specifically to get a good high quality healthcare in India. It's all associated with the cost. And one of the major costs associated with healthcare is medical devices. We import almost around 75% of medical devices in this country. And I'm not against importing. But even after importing these medical devices, I most see that these devices do not solve our problem properly because they were never designed for these settings. Most of you guys might have heard about a case in Uttar Pradesh where hundreds of kids died because oxygen was not there in the ventilator and ventilators were not functioning because of it. But what if these ventilators could function without oxygen? Most of the doctors said if just there was just air, not full oxygen, many of these kids could have survived. But because these devices were not designed for a setting where there was an assumption that oxygen will never go away. I looked more deeply into this problem, that we have best engineers in the world here. We have best doctors in the world here. We have best management people here. But why still we don't have medical devices company which are making big in this country? Why we don't have medical innovations which are solving our own local problem? One thing I realized deep down, it's inside our education system, that we are not trained to work together. As an engineer, I didn't get a training to work with another engineer. So I was trained as an electronics engineer. I never learned how to work with mechanical guy. I get a training of working with a doctor, working with a social worker, working with a business guy. So the whole training of interdisciplinary research, interdisciplinary work, was not there. Then once I got my training in this whole interdisciplinary research on medical device innovation, I learned one more interesting thing. That as a mind, the way we have been, again, trained, we always look for the solution. We never go deep down inside the problems and try to understand them really well. that's where the first thing I realized that if we understand problem really, really well, the solutions become really obvious to us. And that's the whole thesis of my work, that's the whole thesis, the way I do research. To show you the example of the way I started my journey, the way I did this process. So me and my partner, Nachiket, we have spent almost around 3 months in a tertiary care hospital in Bangalore, just observing what are the things which are going wrong. We call it negative outcomes. We were going deep into each problem, each case. We were spending time in emergency room, day in, day out, 24 hours we were there. We were spending time in ambulances, just seeing that what are the things which are leading to anything which is going wrong. So even after doctors putting all the effort, there were few things which they said, I wish if it could have been improved. Doctors knew that this patient could have been saved. We record all those observations, and then we analyze them. We go into real deep problem. Once we analyze those problems, then we come up with solutions. One of those problems which we saw, which was very, very common scenario in a big tertiary care hospital, and I would say this would be the common scenario even at this hospital. India has one of the highest rates of prematurities in neonates. One of the complications and the most common complications of prematurity is respiratory distress syndrome, where these babies can't breathe by themselves. They require some kind of breathing support. But all these breathing support machines are designed to work in high-resource centers. They are designed to work in neonatal ICUs, where just 30% of these births happen. 70% of these babies born outside the centers, where there's no way to provide breathing support available. These babies need to get transferred from all these primary healthcare centers, community healthcare centers, or nursing homes to a center where neonatal ICU is available. More than 30% of these babies lose their lives just during this transportation. And it's a sad thing just because they can't access a piece of technology. These are pictures of existing solutions. Existing solutions require compressed gas, compressed oxygen, continuous electricity, a trained person to be there. These existing solutions are bulky. They cannot be transported. We looked at this problem. We had brainstormed with the doctors. And they told us one thing, that WHO recommend a real simple technology, or it's not even a technology, it's a simple solution for these neonates called CPAP, which is nothing, just continuous positive airway pressure, that you provide these neonates air or mix of oxygen or oxygen at a certain pressure, which will keep their lungs open. Sounds so simple. But here we are talking about pressure of 5 cm of H2O, which you can't even feel. Even if it goes from 5 to 8, it can rupture baby's lung. So you need that kind of accuracy here. We took this as a challenge, and then we designed this device. We call it SARS, which is a Hindi word for breathing. It's world's only neonatal CPAP machine, which can work without electricity, without oxygen, without compressed gas. It can work with... It can work in the hospital, it can work in the ICU, you can take it for any kind of transport. It has one really innovative user mode where you can connect any ambu bag or any bag and mask system to this device, and it'll start delivering pressure to the babies regardless of who is using it. And we are doing all these things at 1/3 of the cost of any existing CPAP machine. And it's not that we are saving we are saving on quality. Our quality is top-notch in the world, but just because we have engineered this whole machine in such a way that we have removed those expensive components and designed new components, and which has saved a lot of cost for us. Can you change the slide? It's not. Yeah. The other problem which I never knew when I was in ICU, I was looking for the patient, I saw a 30-year-old male patient came with head injury. This patient was inside the ICU on a ventilator. This patient was supposed to be out of the ventilator within 2 days. But when I went again, I looked at the patient's file, had discussion with doctors, I overheard patient's family talking about selling their ornaments and their land so they can support patient's care. As you know, ICU care, especially initial days, is one of the most expensive place to be in. When I asked doctor that why this patient is still on ventilator, he was supposed to be out of it after 48 hours. Then doctor said that this patient got an infection called ventilator-associated pneumonia. I thought, I never heard about this. What's it? He said, have you ever heard that patient goes on ventilator or inside the ICU? People come out and they say, this patient got pneumonia. It's not normal pneumonia. It's called ventilator-associated pneumonia. It happens to the patients who are on ventilator. Because of the saliva and secretion which we generate, usually we swallow all of it. We generate close to 1.5 to 2 liters of saliva every day. But we swallow all of it. These patients cannot do it. So then slowly, slowly, all the saliva and secretion start accumulating, goes inside their lungs and infect them. As normal people, we can cuff this secretion out. These patients cannot do it. And this infection, I thought it might be one of the cases in that specific hospital, in that specific center. I did a research. It's a global phenomenon. It's one of the most common and the most deadly hospital-acquired infection one can get. Till now, the solution for this problem was a nurse goes with a catheter or a tube, tries to remove the secretion from the mouth. And then there are antibiotics. So because this is an infection, it has been considered till now largely as a drug problem, not an engineering problem. We looked at this whole scenario and we said, no, it's just aspiration of secretions. And if we make sure that none of the secretion reaches to the lungs, we can reduce chances of getting this infection. And that's what we did. Along with the doctors, that's also from multiple specialists. We had ENT surgeons with us. We had infection disease specialists with us. We had critical care specialists, emergency physician. We all sat together and designed this device. We call it VapCare, which is world's only intelligent secretions and oral hygiene management system, which removes secretions or all this infected fluid from patient's airway, makes sure none of these reaches to the lungs and infect them. This device also pushes antibacterial liquid inside the patient's mouth, rinses the whole oral cavity and takes the fluid out, and makes sure that even oral hygiene is maintained properly. This product has already got FDA certification, and right now we are selling it across the India. Can you put this full slide, last slide. Yeah. Last slide. My whole idea to come and speak in front of a lot of medicos here is many times we think that the whole medical device innovation is what engineers do. But if you look at the most notable medical device innovations across the globe are always done by doctors, because doctors understand problems. Doctors know what really has to be solved. I just encourage you guys, or just ask, just go. In same campus, you have engineering department, you have architecture department, you have business department, go and collaborate with them. Tell them about the problems which you are facing, and then you will see how the solution can go and decimate across the globe. These solution, what we have developed, have already saved hundreds of lives across the 4 countries. And every day we hear news, we get messages from the clinicians, and they thank us that thank God that you guys have designed this machine. And we send them that, no, thank God that you guys have helped us to design this machine. One of my mentor and co-inventor in most of my innovations, Dr. Jagdish Chaturvedi, I always ask him that you are a doctor, you are already saving so many lives. Why do you need to get into an unknown field of medical technology? He said, as a doctor, how many patients I can see in my whole life? He said, best case scenario, 20,000 patients, 30,000 patients. But if I solve these problems using technology, I can scale it up. And within a month, I would be able to save these thousands of lives. So it's not just saving the lives, but saving the lives at scale. And saving the lives, which really matters, either it is poor or either it is rich, everyone's life can be saved if we innovate new technologies for low resource settings like us. Thank you.